Good afternoon, everyone. Welcome to the, I guess, the spring session of the Denton's Labor Spotlight Series. It's a quarterly webinar series that we're offering here at Denton's, focused specifically on labor relations and particularly the practical aspects of labor. So this is our third installment. We're going to be talking about the use of replacement workers during a strike today. And we'll also have a brief session at the end, or section on the end, that talks about bargaining trends, current bargaining trends, just to give everyone a little snapshot into what we're seeing in collective bargaining across Canada right now. So to introduce our speakers today, that's me there, number two. As you can see, I'll be joined by Ariane Bouchard first, who's going to be speaking about Quebec-specific legislation, and Christina Wendell, who will follow her, speaking about Alberta and more general application of restrictions in the rest of Canada on the use of replacement workers. And my colleague Emily Gravoff will be handling questions. So without further ado, I'll hand it over. Oh, actually, I was wrong. Sorry, Christina's going first. So I'll turn it over to Christina.
Perfect. Thanks, Russ. So I'm going to be going through the use of replacement workers during a strike. The examples, the legislation I have, and the essential workers, essential services piece is unique to Alberta. But then I'll just be talking about some general practical considerations as well. Next slide, please. So in Canada, we've got BC and Quebec that do have some bans on the use of replacement workers during a strike. We'll hear about Quebec's specific requirements later on in this webinar. Now, the rest of the provinces in Alberta included don't have statutory restrictions on the use of replacement workers during a strike or lockout. Alberta does have the essential services legislation, which I'll go through in this presentation. For those jurisdictions, and just a note, the federal jurisdiction is expected to introduce legislation later on this year that will introduce a ban on the use of replacement workers during a strike. So for those employers who are federally regulated, you can expect to see that later this year. But for those other provinces, there are no statutory restrictions. And I'll kind of end off my presentation just with some practical considerations when thinking about the use of replacement workers. There are, however, some protections available for striking workers. So in Alberta's Section 9E of the Labor Relations Code requires that when a strike or a lockout ends, and that's in one of three ways, whether it's a result of a settlement, the termination of bargaining rights, or 2 years after the strike has started, then any employee who's affected by the dispute and who hasn't had their employment otherwise terminated can resume employment in preference to any replacement workers who were hired. So they can make a request. It's not automatic. It's a request that the employee has to make in writing within certain timelines, to be reinstated and have the replacement worker exit the workplace and no longer fill that spot. The timelines, it's within 14 days after the employee learns of the strike, or in any event, 30 days after it has ended, or just forthwith if we're looking at the two-year expiration piece. Next slide, please. Section 90, so in Alberta specifically, doesn't prevent the parties from agreeing to a mechanism. So there's nothing to say the parties can otherwise agree to have a mechanism in place for the return to work. And it also doesn't require the employer to reinstate the employee if the employer no longer has persons engaged in that work, or if there's been a suspension or discontinuance of the employer's operations or part of them. So if there's been a function that's been discontinued, which would have been where that employee went in, the employer is not obligated to reinstate that employee. If neither of those apply, then when the employee makes that request in writing, the employer is required to reinstate the employee, but it's on any terms that they will agree on. Of course, subject to the prohibition on discrimination. So the employer can't discriminate against the employee for having been on strike, essentially. Next slide. Now, for Alberta employers who operate in the essential services sphere, the situation is somewhat different. So Part 2, Division 15.1 of Alberta's code requires that certain employers, their bargaining agents, and those bargaining unit employees ensure that essential services will be maintained during a strike or lockout. The code defines essential services as those services, the interruption of which would endanger the life, personal safety, or health of the public, or which are necessary to the maintenance and administration of the rule of law or public security. The division sets out a list of employers who are covered by the division. And so it's the employers, the bargaining agents that represent their employees and those bargaining unit employees, who are then bound by the requirements and the limitations set out in that division for essential services. The list, it's primarily health services type employers, but not exclusively. So it includes the government of Alberta, AHS, hospital operators, nursing home operators, et cetera. So for those employers, they either have to have an essential services agreement in place or have an exemption before a strike or lockout can occur. Just one other thing to note, employers that one might think would be essential services like police and firefighters, they're actually excluded from that. They have a different requirements in place, so they're not considered within that essential services division. They're actually prohibited from strikes or lockouts for those categories of workers. Their remedy, if there is a collective bargaining dispute, is to apply for compulsory arbitration. Next slide. So when looking at an essential services agreement, the parties to the bargaining relationship, so that's the employer and the union, it's their responsibility to negotiate the agreement. Either party can give written notice to the other party to begin negotiations for the agreement. The legislation specifically requires the parties to negotiate in good faith and to make every reasonable effort to enter into the essential services agreement. The essence of the agreement is that it should provide enough bargaining unit employees who will continue to work, providing those essential services in the event there is a strike or a lockout. Those employees are referred to as, makes sense, designated essential services workers, and then those workers are prohibited from participating in the strike or lockout. Next slide. There's a number of provisions that have to be included in the essential services agreement. They have to identify the essential services that are going to be maintained, classify the employees, the number of positions in each classification, talk about how capable and qualified employees are going to be assigned to perform those essential services, dealing with emergencies and foreseeable changes to essential services, any changes to terms and conditions of employment that will be applicable to those designated essential services workers that are continuing to work. So, for example, maybe the overtime provisions will be different. Instead of banking work, they only get paid. Hours of work may be different. Compressed work weeks may be suspended. Things like that can be provided for in the essential services agreement. And then they have to identify one or more umpires who will be the ones that they turn to if there's a dispute. So that would be set out named in the essential services agreement. Next slide. There's also an election that is required by employers. So within a reasonable time, of course, what that is often ends up being subject to debate. But so within a reasonable time after the parties are required to start those negotiations for the essential services agreement, the employer has to make an election. And that election is about how those essential services are going to be performed during a strike or a lockout. And the employer has two options and has to pick one, whether it's going to use designated essential services workers or replacement workers. Now, there's circumstances where the employer is not required to make that election. Those two circumstances are whether or where the bargaining unit employees actually don't perform essential services, or if the employer intends to maintain those essential services during a strike or lockout by either using the services, by using the services of other capable and qualified persons, neither members of the bargaining unit, so no designated essential services workers, nor replacement workers. And essentially that would be where they intend to maintain those essential services through the use of management employees who aren't part of the bargaining unit then. So if an employer fits within one of those two categories, then they can apply to the commission for an exemption. So then they would not, if the exemption is granted, they would not be required to negotiate that essential services agreement. Next slide. Now, for essential services for employers covered by that division who want to use replacement workers, so if they make that election, that's the decision they make in the election, the employer then must, so it's mandatory, has to apply to the commissioner for an exemption order. And that exemption order would then exempt them from having to negotiate an essential services agreement. The commissioner may grant the order, but it has to be satisfied that the essential services that are proposed to be performed by, or that are performed by the bargaining unit employees can be maintained during the strike or lockout as proposed by the employer by the other capable qualified persons, which can include then replacement workers. So you can still have management workers providing those essential services alongside replacement workers, but what you can't have is replacement workers alongside bargaining unit employees performing those essential services. And that exemption has to be granted by the commissioner before the election is valid. If the exemption is granted, then the employer can use replacement workers. So they have to wait until the commissioner grants the exemption to be able to do that. So once the exemption is granted, then the employer can proceed using replacement workers to provide those essential services during a lockout or strike. And again, there's to be no intermingling. So no bargaining unit employees would then be required as designated essential services workers. Employers do have to be careful when applying for that exemption that they have properly determined the use of replacement workers and set that out, because if they overestimate their ability to do that, and then there is a strike and there's an issue where they're not able to provide the essential services as they had stated they would be with the replacement workers, then they'll have to go to the board for an emergency order. And the board, if they think the employer didn't estimate things properly, they can award significant costs against the employer at that application. So employers do have to be very cautious. Next slide. There is a standard form the Labor Relations Board provides for applying for that exemption. And as part of that, there is an individual who's authorized by the employer who actually has to make a statutory declaration, essentially declaring that the employer's plans will ensure that essential services are maintained during a strike and that the plan for the replacement workers is reasonably practicable. And also that the employer is going to make best efforts to implement those plans. And those applications are typically decided without oral evidence. Next slide. So that is just a very brief summary of how the essential workers, essential services division of the Alberta Labor Relations Code works. But again, other than that, or even for those essential services employers who then can use replacement workers. So the question then is whether they should use replacement workers. Now, certainly on the pro side, using replacement workers gives the employers the ability to continue running the business, continue to operate, do what it is the bargaining unit employees would otherwise have been doing. But there are a number of potential negative implications that employers should consider when thinking about whether they're going to use replacement workers. One of the main considerations would be the potential for violence. The use of replacement workers will often result in high conflict picket lines. And so I remember growing up in the 80s, in Alberta, there was the Gainers' strike. Peter Pocklington, for those of you who know the Oilers, is generally hated for many reasons, but he's the one who traded Wayne Gretzky. But he was also the owner of the Gainers meatpacking plant. And throughout the early mid 80s, there was a lot of disputes, a lot of issues with the workers. And ultimately that culminated in 1986 when they went on strike. That strike has been referred to as the one of the most violent ones in Alberta. And one of the issues that came into play was the use of replacement workers. So Gainers was busting in replacement workers. Of course, you've got the picketing union workers who would then prevent the buses from entering the plant. Gainers ended up going to court fairly quickly, got an injunction, and then that pulled in the police. You had the first use of Alberta's riot squad. There was, like, I think, 300 arrests within the very first couple of days. So it became very violent. It was on the news nightly. And ultimately, it may have delayed the resolution as well. So that's one incident that comes to mind, is that need for consideration of the potential for violence. What's going to happen if they bring in replacement workers? Tying into that is the potential for the need for increased security. So in the Gainers strike, you had the police force, basically, who were tasked with taking steps to make sure the replacement workers could enter the plant. But then there was another one in the Northwest Territories in the early 90s, the giant mine case, which actually ended up being very violent from the outset during that strike. And the employer in that case ended up hiring a company to provide security for the site because there was numerous breaches and concerns and violence around the mine. That one did end up being incredibly violent as well, and actually resulted in the death of 9 workers, including a number of replacement workers in the mine following a bomb that was set by one of the striking workers. So those, obviously are very extreme situations, but do come into play and are things that employers need to consider. The next point there, the potential for lengthier labor disputes. I've seen some comments and some studies kind of either way. There's some comments that the provinces that have the replacement ban legislation in place end up having lengthier labor disputes, but then I've heard some on the other side. But again, just something to consider. If you start using replacement workers, how is that going to impact the resolution of the dispute? And then the final point there is the health and safety concerns. So the employer needs to consider, is it going to be able to bring in replacement workers, have them trained, get them the experience needed to safely run the operation during a strike or a lockout in time? And those I think are really the key considerations, balancing those with the need to continue to run the business. So with that, I'll turn it over to Ariane to talk about the Quebec provisions.
Thank you, Christina. Everybody, as Christina mentioned, there are two jurisdictions in Canada right now that have restrictions on the use of replacement workers. Quebec is one of them. And today I'm going to talk to you about the specific restriction that are in the labor code of Quebec. So the labor code basically is the main law governing collective labor relations in the provincially regulated companies in Quebec. So it does not include companies that are federally regulated as bank, railways, telecommunications. But for every provincially regulated, that would be the law governing the unionization process, the collective bargaining, grievance arbitration, and labor disputes. Just to mention that there are a few separate statutes that would create specific regime that are distinct from the labor code for certain sector. In the construction industry, they have their own law. In the entertainment industries as well, for every artist, they have their own statute. And the home daycares as well have their own statute. And unlike the labor code, those laws do not contain any provision prohibiting the use of replacement workers. So, for example, this is why when there are strikes in the construction industries, for example, it can be possible to bring workers, qualified workers from other provinces. Next slide, please. So the section that prohibits or at least greatly restrict the use of replacement workers in Quebec during a strike or a lockout is section 109.1. So what it says basically is that for the duration of a strike declared in accordance with this code or lockout, every employer is prohibited. And then we have actually seven sections that put restrictions. So I will not read the section because I will discuss this exception one by one, but I just wanted to put in my presentation the reference to the actual legislation. If we can go to the next slide, please, and one slide after that again, so because this was the whole section 100.9.1. So the first, as it was mentioning, the precondition for the restrictions to apply is that we must be in a lockout, or in the case of a strike that is declared in accordance with the labor code. So it means that if it's an illegal strike because the requirement of the code has not been followed, the restriction won't apply. Employer would be able to use replacement worker technically. So the condition as that the strike must be declared by an employee association that is certified to represent the affected employee group. So before the certification, it's not possible for a group employee to strike. And the second condition is that the strike must be declared within the time period that are permitted by the labor code. So in short, it's minimum 90 days after the issuance of the notice to bargain by a party. It can be either the employer or the union. It can never be during the term of a collective agreement. And it can also never be after the party submitted their dispute to an arbitrator if they are unable to agree themselves. There are also additional obligations or preconditions in the public services that must be respected to ensure that essential services are maintained. So additional notice must be given. Parties should agree on essential service, but I'm not covering that into my presentation today. Just wanted to mention it. There are also other obligations when you start a strike, but failure to comply with those obligations would not affect the legality of the strike itself. So you will still not be able to use replacement worker even if the union has not followed those condition. So just shortly, even a strike technically shall be authorized by a secret ballot decided by the majority vote of the member of the certified association who are comprising the bargaining unit. And there is also an obligation to notify the Minister of Labor in writing within 40 hours following the declaration of the strike. But even if it's not done, the strike is still considered legal. Next slide, please. So as we will see, section 100.9, what it says, it always mentions, it uses a lot the concept that you can use the service, you cannot use the services of a replacement worker. What does it mean to use the services? First, the case law has determined that the verb use imply a positive act by the user. Consequently, when an employer indirectly and passively benefits from the services of individual, it does not use their services. This was decided actually by the Supreme Court of Canada in a decision where the employer on strike was the owner of show, like a show, a room to do show, and people were renting that location and use their own worker, and it was indirectly benefiting the employer, but it was decided that those people still cannot be considered as replacement worker in a situation like that. Conversely, actively subcontracting services that are normally performed by striking employee amounts to use the service of the subcontractor, which is prohibited, as we will see a bit later in the presentation. An employer cannot defend itself in a complaint for illegal use of replacement worker by saying that it has given strict instruction to its employees or to its manager not to perform the duty of striking employee. This will generally not be considered a sufficient ground of defense because the employer is liable for the action of those acting under its direction contrary to its instruction. And this is especially true if this is the people or management personnel. So therefore, even if it's an implied or tacit use of the person, it's contrary to section 109.1. And also another thing is that the prohibition's use of service is really for any type of work, even occasional work. There are a lot of examples in the case law where employer would try to say, yeah, but it was just one time. It was not something regular, and it's not a valid ground of defense. Next slide, please. So as we saw in section 109.1, there are a lot of the restriction that will only apply in the establishment where the strike or lockout has been declared. And it brings the question of what is the establishment. So there was a decision from the Court of Appeal that was rendered in 2011, where it was decided that the concept of establishment is really limited to the physical establishment to which the striking employees report. Like the actual physical building, like they would say, like the building was door as theoretically being locked by the employer. This is the image that the court would give. Thus, an employer would not violate the provision of the labor code by having contractor that carry out the task of the lockout employee as long as it's done outside the establishment to which the employees report. And actually, in that case, it was the Journal de Québec, so it was a newspaper. So the locked out employee were actually never working in the physical establishment, like themselves were going like on the place where some of them, it was at the National Assembly of Quebec, some of them it was like at where the hockey team was playing. They would not actually work in the establishment, and the replacement worker were also doing their work from those locations, but it was decided that because it was not in the physical establishment, it was okay. And the reason basically that they gave to explain that is that one of the main reasons why replacement workers are prohibited is to prevent violence on the picket line. So this is why it should be really tied up to the physical establishment itself. However, there was a decision that was rendered by the labor tribunal, the administrative labor tribunal, in late 2021. There is an application for judicial review that has been heard at the beginning of 2023. So we don't know what will happen with that decision. But in that decision, it was decided that the widespread deployment of telework as a result of the COVID-19 pandemic justified to revisit the concept of establishment. And basically, the tribunal ruled that to the extent that the employer establishment is deployed to allow work to be performed by telecommuting employees from their homes and under the authority of the employer in the same manner as they were in the physical establishment, it is appropriate to hold that these workers are performing the work in the establishment. So in that case, the employer had give work as assigned a non-unionized employee to do work of the employees on strike. She was doing it from home. Normally, the provision of the code prohibits that type of work to be done in the establishment. And that was the ground of defense of the employer. Like, she is not in the establishment, but the tribunal dismissed that ground of defense and say, because remote work is so common right now, like if a person is regularly doing remote work, this should be, and report to an establishment, this should be considered as if she was in the establishment. Obviously, we don't know what will happen with that. As I mentioned, there is an application for judicial review. It's very likely that it would go to the Court of Appeal after that. And it must be mentioned that when it was the decision, Journal de Québec, before the labor tribunal, actually the tribunal gave upheld the complaint of the union in the first place, and it was only at the stage of the Court of Appeal that it was reversed. So will it be the same thing that time? We don't know, but we will follow that for you and let you know, obviously. Next slide, please. So the limits on the use of the replacement worker themselves, the first two of the provisions, so C and D, are regarding using employees included in the bargaining unit affected by the strike or the lockout, so the striking employee themselves. There are very limited possibility to use the service of those employees. The only exception that are allowed by the code is first, if there is an agreement for the use of the service of a worker between the employer and the union. In the public service, you can also use them if it's provided by a list of essential service, or if it's according to a decision of the tribunal acting in his essential service capacity. And this is the same for the public and parapublic sector. In all cases, the use of the service shall be limited to what the tribunal has agreed or decided, or what is on the list or the agreement of the party. You can go broader than that. And it should be a different bullet, I'm sorry, but there are also a complete prohibition to use the service of the employee on strike or lockout in any other establishment of the employer. So if somebody in the union does not agree with the strike and would like to continue to work in another establishment of the employer, it's not possible. You have to, you can give work to employees on strike. Next slide, please. After that, the next category that I will cover is the other employees of the employer. I'm using employees within the meaning of the labor code, so it does not include the manager. We will talk about that them a bit later. So there's a complete prohibition to use in an establishment where a strike or lockout has been declared the service of a person employed in another establishment. Person here, it's broader, so, but obviously it includes employees and non-employee. So it prevents the employer to use current non-management employee coming from another establishment, including, for example, those that would do the same work as a unionized employee in another establishment. You can bring them to perform the work of the striking employee in the establishment where a strike or lockout has been declared. You would notice that the prohibition is not limited to the discharge of the duties of the employee on strike or lockout, but it really covers any work that could be performed in the establishment affected by the strike or lockout. However, it does not prevent the employer from reassigning the work employee on strike or lockout we're doing, as long as this work is not performed in the establishment where the strike is taking place. So for example, if you are able to take that work and bring that to another location, this is allowed by the code. Next slide, please. There are two other provision that applies to a non-management employee. So a provision to use in an establishment where a strike or a lockout has been declared the service of an employee employed in the establishment to discharge the duty of an employee on strike or lockout. So it prevents the employer to use non-management employee coming from the establishment on strike to perform the normal work of employee on strike or lockout. However, it does not prevent non-unionized employee or employee from unit not on strike or lockout to perform work in the establishment on strike and lockout, as long as it's not the duties of the employee. In the case of duty normally, also I wanted to mention that when, for example, duties are shared by union employee and non-union employee, obviously the non-union employee can continue to do their normal job, so the work that is shared, but they can take on more responsibility, like it has to remain within the same scope. The third provision that would apply is regarding the date of hire. So there's a prohibition to use the service of a person hired by the employer after the beginning of the negotiation stage to discharge an employee's duties on strike or lockout. So it would prevent employer to use non-manager employee, both from the establishment that is on strike or lockout, or otherwise to perform the normal work of the striking employee. The provision is not limited to the establishment where the strike or lockout has been declared. It's anywhere. And just to mention that the negotiation stage, it actually begins on the date on which the notice to bargain is received by the employer or the union, depending of who send it, or acted, or alternatively, if no notice to bargain is sent, the date of the expiry of the collective agreement. Next slide, please. After that, the manager of the employer. Briefly, what is a manager? So it's when the employer want to claim that the person is a manager and fit in the exception, they have the burden to prove it. A manager is usually a person that is vested with the ability to assign work, control or monitor the execution of the work, evaluate the employee. They can hire and terminate employee, but it's not always essential. And it's also recognized by the case law that a person who does not exercise line authority on any other employee still can be a manager but in that case, they would need to have significant authority to bind the employer to third party or be highly involved in the strategic orientations of the company. So when it comes to manager, there are complete prohibition to use them in an establishment where a strike or lockout has been declared. If they are manager coming from another establishment, so again, you would see that the prohibition is not limited to the discharge of the duties of the employer on strike. It applies to any work in the establishment where the strike has been declared. Next slide, please. And you also have a prohibition to use the service of a manager that has been hired after the negotiation phase. So as we saw, the negotiation phase started on the date that the notice to bargain is received. Other manager from the establishment, so those that were hired prior to the beginning of the negotiation phase, they can be used as a replacement worker. Just to clarify, that prohibition applies even if the manager has been hired to replace another person who left the company. So even if it was not, if it's not an additional person that you add to the management team, but it's really like to replace a departure, it would still apply. Next slide, please. After that, there's also a prohibition to use the employee of another employer or contractor, as replacement worker in the establishment where the strike or lockout has been declared. It applies even if such other employer or contractor acts free of charge. And it does not prevent the employer from contracting out the work of employee on strike or lockout as long as the contractor or its employee does not perform such work in the establishment where a strike or lockout has been declared. Next slide, please. So there are exceptions to use replacement worker. First, if the union does not respect an agreement or does not respect a list of essential services, the employer can have replacement worker performing the work that the union was supposed to do during the strike. And so, next slide, please. The second exception that is more often used is that the application of the provision regarding prohibition to use replacement worker does not affect or prevent an employer from taking, where such is the case, the necessary measure to avoid the destruction or serious deterioration of his property. But this shall exclusively be conservation measure and not measure designed to enable the continuation of the production or good of service. The case law has determined that the risk of destruction or deterioration must be probable, imminent, and not merely hypothetical or apprehended. The measure taken must be strictly limited to what is necessary. And if it's possible to take the measure without breaching the section 109.1, for example, by using a manager, the employer should prefer that option before using prohibited replacement worker. Next slide, please. So basically, just to mention that if the union suspect that the employer is using replacement worker, they can ask the Minister of Labor to perform an investigation. So somebody from the ministry will come and they have the right to come and to visit any place in the workplace. They will make a report at the end, and such report can be used before the tribunal, but it's not binding on the tribunal. Next slide, please. The other thing that you need to know is that employer may request safeguard orders to have the employer stop using replacement worker if they feel that it's doing it. So to be successful in such application, the union must then prove that there is a sufficient appearance of right, so a sufficient proof that employer is using replacement worker, that it will suffer irreparable harm if the safeguard order is not issued, and that the balance of convenience favor the issuance of an order. And at that stage, the proof is made by affidavits, the content of which is taken as proven by the tribunal. Next slide, please. And finally, what are the consequences for the use of replacement workers? So they are both penal or civil consequences. So using replacement worker when you're not allowed to do so is an offense and is liable to a fine of not more than $1,000 for every day or quarter of day during which the offense continue. Obviously, it takes a proof beyond reasonable doubt to be convicted on that. And in most cases, what we would see is that the union would rather take a civil case. They would ask for an order to be rendered by against the employer to request that they stop using replacement worker. And if the tribunal finds that, yes, they were doing it, they can order the employer to stop using certain persons. So obviously this is a prerequisite to file a contempt claim after that. So this is why union is taking this route first. They must also order the employer to allow union representative to go visit the workplace at any time during the labor dispute to ensure that the provision of the code are respected. This is rarely done. They may order the employer to pay damage, but this is very rare in practice. Next slide. So I know that this was probably confusing. There was a lot of information in what I said. The the prohibition interact one with the other. So I made a little summary that you may go back to after the presentation if you want to better understand for which category of employee what they can or can do. Obviously, the time is running, so I won't read out of that, and I will pass along to Ras. Thank you.
Great. Thanks so much, Ariane. And thanks, Christina, for that. Those two great talks. We're trying to incorporate a short overview of bargaining trends in these sessions, just to give people a sense of where things are at, whether or not you're in bargaining or not, just to give you a lay of the land for what we're seeing when we're bargaining with our other clients. So next slide, please. So I'll be relatively brief and then we'll have some time for questions. Like I said, I'm going to look at wage trends as well as how bargaining is being resolved and how we're seeing some distinct differences from what we experienced in prior years. Obviously the elephant in the room is inflation. We're seeing it everywhere. When we go to the grocery store, filling up our cars and so on. Now, the good news is that after years of low inflation and then the spike that we all saw, it does seem to be abating. So inflation was up around, I think, 8.1% was the CPI in June of 2022. But since that point, it's been steadily dropping. Maybe we'll look at the next slide. I'll come back to the inflation piece, but it's kind of like the background. It's what's pushing all of this. So we can see annual average base wage increases in the deals that are being reached here in the public sector and private sector. And we can see that things are fairly consistent up until we hit Q2 or Q1 of 2022. And then they really jump up, basically doubling in terms of the percentage wage increase that has been seen. And that's basically when we saw this spike in inflation. So we'll see that again in the next chart. So next slide. Yeah. So you can see here that things were fairly consistent for years in terms of percentage increases in both, in public and private sector until we get this spike up that we saw on that previous slide. Next slide. And here it is again by sector this time. You see the broader public sector is at the top here. You've got municipal, federal, and private sector. Private sector is the one that's up top. But basically, they've all really jumped up from this baseline of between 1.5% and 2%. Into the stratosphere of 4%. So big jumps. And unions are basically leveraging the CPI argument to attain these at the bargaining table, and not without merit. Obviously, there has been some real consequences on workers in terms of the cost of living in Canada over the last few years. Next slide. It's another chart broken down by industry. You can see the jumps by year. So we've got in each one of these tranches, 20, 21, 22, and then 23. So we're seeing a progressive spike up. Next slide. And so just on that point, what we're expecting is that inflation will keep coming down, which will give employers a little bit of leverage at the table to say that there's no longer this consistent price impact on the members that can validate unions' claims for higher wages. But flip side, these prices are baked in. We're not seeing deflation. Prices aren't going down. Just the rate of increase is slowing to something that we would consider more normal. So unions will continue to hammer employers, I think, with these arguments that their members are entitled to big jumps to account for the big jump that occurred over the last year in prices. And hopefully inflation remains on the downtrend, but we expect unions to keep using that as a bargaining chip. This is an interesting stat. We looking just at 2022, you can see how resolutions were reached in bargaining. In a lot of cases, direct bargaining, you know, 16%. We get arbitration or mediation gets you another 40%, conciliation another 20%. And you're seeing work disruptions at 23%, which is significant. And we'll see in the next slide, we picked, we picked a pre-pandemic year, so 2019, but this is pretty typical for, 2017, 2018, 2019. You see that direct bargaining is actually resolving a huge chunk of the agreements, the negotiations, and work disruption was only 1%. So if we flip back one, so you can see work disruptions in last year, massive compared to the previous years pre-COVID. So I think employees and unions are more willing to go on strike over these issues. The wage issue is big at the bargaining table and looming large. So employers can expect that. I think it's unavoidable for the next few years until the inflation is maybe built into the current wages. Okay, so next slide. I'll turn it over to questions for Emily.
Hey, hi everyone. So we just had a few questions come in through the Q&A box. Starting off with where did the collective or wage-related data come from? So that data was taken from Collective Bargaining Ontario. The data is actually posted publicly if you want to take a look at it after the presentation, but that is all available online. Moving more so into the substantive questions, Ariane, we're going to start off with a question for you. So we had a question come in asking if you think employers in jurisdictions that prevent the use of replacement workers are at a disadvantage at the bargaining table.
Yeah, this is certainly an additional challenge for the employer, because to run a business with very limited people can be a lot more complicated. So in most, especially if the employer intend to remain like open and to continue its operation during the strike or the lockout, this add a lot of challenge. So it can put more pressure on the employer, like to accepting at the negotiation table, obviously. That being said, we have operated like this way in Quebec for a long time, but like there are a lot of lobby by employers association right now for those limit to be reduced, especially like some of them, for example, the one prohibiting the manager hired after the beginning of the negotiation phase. There are a lot of lobby that if you hire someone to replace a departure person, like they should be allowed to do the work as well, because otherwise it's very a big disadvantage. So yes.
Okay, great. Thank you. Conversely, Christina, kind of the second part of the same question, do you feel that employers in jurisdictions such as Alberta that permit the use of replacement workers are at an advantage at the bargaining table?
Thanks, Emily. Yeah, I think that's certainly the view. And if you look at the history of the essential services ban in Alberta, so when we had the NDP, who very much is a union-friendly government, they introduced a ban on the use of replacement workers for essential services. And then we had the UCP came in a few years ago, and they removed that ban. So certainly the view from employers is that it is an advantage to not have that ban. They view it as kind of being something that addresses the imbalance where you have employees who are on strike who can go work somewhere else and get the strike pay, but then the employers during a strike or lockout have their hands tied in terms of what they can do.
Okay. Great. Thank you, Christina. And then Ariane, we just have one last question for you. Yeah. So a question came in asking about what other jurisdictions limit the use of replacement workers, and does the federal government intend to restrict the use of replacement workers?
Yeah, so as mentioned, yes, there are Quebec and BC right now that are the only two jurisdictions like really limited the use of replacement worker like in all industries. And the federal government has announced that in 2023, we don't know when yet, they intend to introduce a bill prohibiting the restricting the use of replacement workers as well. So this is something that we will monitor for you and that we will talk. Our next webinar is actually on trends in the federal sector. So we would be able like to, hopefully we will have more detail at that time to share with the attendees.
Hey, great. Thanks to both of you for answering those questions. And I'll just pass it off to Russ to kind of wrap this up for today.
Great. Ariane, you stole my thunder. I was going to talk about the next webinar. If we have the next slide. the next webinar are probably going to be scheduled for June. Try and get it in before summer kicks in. But we're going to be talking about trends, labor trends in the federal sector specifically. And as Ariane mentioned, we're hoping to have a little more information about what the government's proposing and how that could affect the use of replacement workers in the federal sector. Just one note, being from Ontario here, we have a relatively or highly conservative government. And so there's no legislation blocking use of replacement workers here, but the NDP is pushing for it here as well. We'll assume that I won't go through for now, but that's always looming here in Ontario. Great, so I think that's it. Thank you very much. We'll be following up with an email that has the presentation deck and the recording. Don't forget to go to the Denton's Labor Spotlight Series website or page on our Denton's website, where you can see recordings, a history of past recordings, webinars. You can watch whenever you want. As well as prior insights. So we're trying to publish a labor insight on some practical labor issue once every few months to sort of go hand in hand with this webinar series. So you'll see our catalog, our back catalog of insights there for you to download. If you have any thoughts or feedback for us, please don't hesitate to reach back and send us an email with some suggestions even for the next topics coming up. So thank you for your time and have a good day.